If a man is righteous and does what is lawful and right, if he has not exacted usury nor taken any increase, but has withdrawn his hand from all iniquity and executed true judgment between men and men, if he has walked in my statutes and kept my judgment faithfully, then he is just and he shall surely live. But if he has exacted usury and taken increase, shall he then live? No, he shall not live. If he has done any of these abominations, he shall surely die, says the Lord our God.
And yet you live from day to day by theft and robbery.
And tell me what?
For a usurer is a thief and a robber. He shall rightly be hanged on the gallows 7 times higher than other thieves. Indeed, you trample all of God's commandments under your sins.
Adiutorum nostrum.
Jessica.
In truth, I know not why I'm so sad. It wearies me. You say it wearies you. I'm such a want wit, sadness makes me that I have much ado to know myself.
Your mind is tossing on the ocean.
Believe me, sir, had I such venture for, the better part of my affection
would be with my hopes abroad. I should be still plucking the grass to know where sits the wind, peering in maps for ports and piers and roads, and every object that might make me fear misfortune to my ventures, out of doubt would make me sad.
My wind, cooling my broth, would blow me to a fever if I thought what harm a wind too great might do at sea.
Believe me, no.
Well, then you're in love.
Fie, fie, fie.
Not in love either? Then let us say you are sad, because you are not merry. Here comes my Lord Bassanio.
Ah, good morrow, my good lord.
Signors both, when shall we laugh? Say when.
We shall make our leisures to fit in with yours.
Bassanio.
Bassanio? My Lord Bassanio, since you have found Antonio, we too will leave you.
You look not well,
Signor Antonio. You have too much respect upon the world. They lose it that do buy it with much care.
I hold the world, but as the world, Graziano. A stage where every man must play his part. And mine a sad one.
Come, good Lorenzo. Fare thee well a while, and then my exhortation after dinner.
Fare thee well.
Graziano speaks an infinite deal of nothing, more than any man in all of Venice.
Well? Tell me now. That which today you promised to tell me of.
Tis not unknown to you, Antonio, how much I have disabled my estate. But my chief care is to come squarely out of the great debts wherein my youth, something too prodigal, has left me pledged. To you, Antonio, I owe the most in money and in love. And from your love, I have a warranty to unburden all my plots and purposes, how to get clear of all the debts I owe.
I pray you, good Bassanio, let me know it. And if it stand, as you yourself still do, within the eye of honor, be assured, my purse, my person, my extremest means, lie all unlocked to your occasion.
In Belmont is a lady richly left, and she is fair, and fairer than that word of wondrous virtues. Sometimes, from her eyes, I did receive fair, speechless messages. Her name is Portia, no less a beauty than Cato's daughter, Brutus Portia. Nor is the wide world ignorant of her worth, for the four winds blow in from every coast renowned suitors. Oh, my Antonio, had I but the means to hold a rival place with one of them, then I should questionless be fortunate.
Thou knowest my fortunes are at sea. Neither have I money nor commodity to raise a present sum. Therefore, go forth. Try what my credit can in Venice do. It shall be racked even to the uttermost to furnish you to Belmont and fair Portia.
I swear to you, Nerissa, I am aweary of this great world.
You would be, sweet madam, if your miseries were as plentiful as your good fortunes are. And yet, from what I see, they are as sick that have it in excess as those that starve with nothing.
If doing were as easy as knowing what were good to do, chapels had been churches, and poor men's cottages princes' palaces. But this reasoning is not in the way to choose me a husband. Oh, may the word choose. I may neither choose who I would, nor refuse who I dislike. So is the will of a living daughter ruled by a dead father. Oh, is it not hard, Nerissa? That I cannot choose one, nor refuse none.
Your father was always virtuous, and holy men at their death have good inspirations. Therefore, the lottery that he devised in these three chests of gold and silver and lead, so that who chooses his meaning chooses you, no doubt only be guessed rightly by someone who you shall rightly love.
Right. What warmth is there in your affection towards any of these princely suitors that are already come?
I pray you name them. And as you name them, I will describe them, and according to my description, level at my affection.
I see you by the French lord, Monsieur Le Bon.
Oh, God. God made him, and therefore let him pass for a man.
I know it is a sin to be a mocker, but he...
What say you then to Falconbridge, the young Baron of England?
How oddly he's suited.
And the Duke of Saxony's nephew?
Very rarely in the morning when he is sober, and most rarely in the afternoon when he is drunk. Oh, Nerissa!
Wait! If he should offer to choose, and choose the right casket, you should refuse to perform your father's will if you should refuse to accept him.
Therefore, for fear of the worst, I pray thee, set a deep glass of Rhenish wine on the contrary casket. I will do anything, Nerissa. And I will be married to a sponge!
$3,000 ducats. Wow.
Aye, sir. For 3 months.
For 3 months. Wow.
Which is our dojo? Antonio shall be bound.
Antonio shall be bound? Wow.
May you help me? Will you pleasure me? Shall I know your answer?
3,000 ducats for 3 months. And Antonio bound.
Your answer to that?
Antonio is a good man.
Have you heard any imputation to the contrary?
No. My meaning in saying that he is a good man is to have you understand that he is of good credit. Yet his means are in question. He hath a ship bound for Tripolis, another to the Indies. I understand, moreover, upon the Rialto, he hath a third ship at Mexico, a fourth for England, and other ventures he hath squandered abroad. But ships are but boards. Sailors are but men. There be land rats and water rats, water thieves and land thieves. I mean pirates. Then there is the peril of waters, winds and rocks. The man is, notwithstanding, of good credit. 3,000 ducats. I think I may take his bond.
Be assured you may.
May I speak with Anton?
If it please you, dine with us.
Yes, to smell pork. To eat of the habitation which your prophet the Nazarite conjured the devil into. I will buy with you, sell with you, walk with you, talk with you, and so following, but I will not eat with you, nor drink with you, nor pray with you. Will see comes here.
This is Signor Antonio. Antonio! Antonio!
Oh, like a fawning publican here.
Shylock! Shylock, you're here!
I am debating of my present story, and by the mere guess of my memory, I cannot instantly raise up the gross full 3,000. But Jubal, a wealthy Hebrew of my tribe, will furnish me. Benjamin, go, seek out Jubal. But soft, how many months? Rest you fair. Good senor, your worship was the last man in our mouths.
Is he yet possessed how much he would?
Aye, aye. 3,000 ducats.
And for 3 months.
Ah, I forgot. 3 months, you told me so? But, soft, methods you said you neither lend nor borrow with interest.
I do never use it.
Well, 3,000 ducats. 'Tis a good round sum.
Lancelot,
the rates. Three months from 12. Well, let me see the rate.
Well, Shylock, shall we be beholden to you?
Signor Antonio, many a time and oft in the Rialto, you have reviled me about my monies and my usances. Still, I have borne it with a patient shrug, for sufferance is the badge of all our tribe. You call me misbeliever, cutthroat dog, and spit upon my Jewish gabardine. And all for use of that which is mine own. Well, it now appears you need my help. You come to me and you say, Shylock, we would have money. You say so. You, that did void your room upon my beard, and kick me as you spurn a stranger cur over your threshold. Money is your suit. What should I say to you? Should I not say, hath a dog money? Is it possible a cur can lend 3,000 ducats? Or shall I bend low and in a slavish voice with bated breath and whispering humbleness say this? Fair sir, you spat on me on Wednesday last. You spurned me such a day. Another time, you called me dog. And for these courtesies, I'll lend you thus much money.
I must like to call you so again. To spit on you again, to spurn you too. If you would lend this money, lend it not unto your friends, for when did friendship take a breed for barren metal from his friends? But lend it rather to your enemy, who, if he break, you may with better face exact the penalty.
Why, look how you storm. I would be friends with you and have your love. Forget the stains that you have shamed me with. Supply your present wants, and take not a drop of interest for my monies. And you'll not hear me.
This is kind, I offer.
This is kindness.
No.
This kindness I will show.
Go with me. to a notary and seal me there your single bond. And in a merry sport, if you repay me not on such a day, in such a place, such a sum or sums as are expressed in the condition, let the forfeit be nominated for an equal pound of your fair flesh to be cut off and taken in what part of your body pleaseth me.
Content, your faith. I'll seal to such a bond and say there is much kindness in the Jew.
You shall not seal such a bond for me. I'd rather live in my necessity.
I fear not, man.
I will not forfeit it. Within these 2 months, as a month before this bond expires, I do expect return of thrice, three times the value of this bond.
Oh, Father Abraham, what these Christians are, whose own hard dealings teaches them, suspect the thoughts of others, I pray you. Tell me this. If he should break his day, what should I gain by the exaction of the forfeiture? A pound of a man's flesh taken from a man is not so estimable. Profitable neither as flesh of muttons, beefs, or goats. I say to buy his favor, I extend this friendship. If he will take it, so. If not, I do. And for my love, I pray you, wrong me not.
Shylock, I will seal unto this bond.
Dislike me not for my complexion, the shadowed livery of the burnished sun to whom I am a neighbor and near bred.
Yalla!
Yalla! Bring me the fairest creature, northward born, where the sun's fire scarce thaws the icicles, and let us make incision for your love to prove whose blood is reddest, his or mine. I tell thee, lady, this aspect of mine hath feared the valiant. Yea, by my love, I swear. The most regarded virgins of our clime hath loved it too, eh? I would not change this hue, except to steal your thoughts, my gentle queen.
In terms of choice, I am not solely led by nice direction of a maiden's eyes. Instead, the lottery of my destiny bars me the right of voluntary choosing. But if my father had not restrained me and hedged me by his wit to yield myself as wife to him who wins me by that means I told you. Yourself, renowned prince, then stood as fair as any comer I have looked on yet for my affection.
Even for that, I thank you. Therefore, I pray you, lead me to the caskets to try my fortune.
I pray you, Leonardo, these things being bought and orderly bestowed, return in haste, for I do feast tonight my best esteemed acquaintance.
Let supper be ready at the latest by 9 o'clock. See that these letters are delivered. And put the livery to the making.
Certainly my conscience would forbid me to run from this Jew, my master.
Oh! I pray you, which way to the master Jews?
Do you not know me, father?
Lord, how art thou changed? How dost thou and thy master agree? I've brought him a present.
famished in his service, father. I'm glad you've come. Give your present to Unmaster Bassanio, who indeed gives rare new liveries.
Graziano,
I have suit to you.
You have obtained it.
You must not deny me.
I must go with you to Belmont.
Why, then you must. But hear thee, Graziano, you are too wild, too rude, too bold of voice. Things that become you happily enough, and in such eyes as ours appears not false. But where you are not known, why, there they show something too
liberal.
Pray you take pain to dilute with some cold drops of modesty your skipping spirit, lest through your wild behavior I be misconstrued in the place I go and lose my hopes.
Signor Bassanio, hear me. If I do not put on a sober habit, talk with respect and swear but now and then, look demurely, nay more while grace is saying, hood mine eyes thus with my hat, and sigh and say amen, never trust me more.
Well,
we shall see your bearing.
Nay, but I bought tonight. You shall not gauge me by what we do tonight.
God bless your worship.
Signor Bassanio.
Many thanks. Would you something from me?
Here is my son, sir. A poor boy.
Not a poor boy, sir, but the rich Jew's man that would, sir, as my father shall specify.
He hath a great infection, sir, as one would say, to serve.
Indeed, sir, the short and the long is I serve the Jew and have a desire, as my father shall specify. To be brief, the very truth is, as my father being an old man shall fruitify unto you.
I have here a dish of doves I would bestow upon your worship. And my suit is...
In very brief, the suit is impertinent to myself, as your worship shall know by this honest old man. And though I say it, though old man, yet poor man, my father.
One speak for both. What would you?
Serve you, sir.
That is the very defect of the matter, sir.
You have obtained your suit. If it be a preferment to leave a rich Jew's service to become the follower of so poor a gentleman.
The old proverb is very well parted between my master Shylock and you, sir. You have the grace of God, sir, and he has enough.
You speak it well. Give him a livery more guarded than his fellows. See it done.
Devil did rob it of some taste of tediousness. Lancelot, soon at supper, shall you see Lorenzo, who is thy new master's guest? Give him this letter. Do it secretly. And so farewell. I would not have my father see me talk with thee.
Adieu. Tears exhibit my tongue. Most beautiful pagan, most sweet Jew.
Oh, Lorenzo, if thou keep promise, I shall end this strife, becoming Christian and your loving wife.
Jessica!
You will see. Your eyes will be the judge, the difference of old Shylock and Bassanio. You will not gormandize with him, as you have done with me, nor sleep and snore and wear apparel out. Not with him. Jessica, I say.
Why, Jessica?
Who bids you call? I do not bid you call.
Your worship was used to say I could do nothing without bidding.
Huh? Call you? What's your will?
I am bid forth to supper, Jessica.
And my keys. Wherefore should I go? I am not bid for love. Oh, they flatter me. Yet I will go and feed upon the prodigal Christian. Jessica, my girl, look to my house. Oh, I am right loath to go. There is some ill a-brewing toward my rest. For I did dream of money bags tonight.
I beseech you, sir, go. My young master expects your reproach.
So do I his.
And they've conspired together. I will not say you shall see a mask, but if you do, it was not for nothing that my nose fell a-bleeding on Black Monday last, 6 o'clock in the morning.
What are their masks? Hear you me, Jessica. Clamber not you up to the casements, then. Nor thrust your head into the public street to gaze on Christian fools with varnished faces. Let not the sound of shallow foppery enter my sober house. Oh, by Jacob's staff, I swear I have no mind of feasting forth tonight. But I will go. Go you before, sirrah. Say I will come.
I will go before, sir. Mistress, look out the window for all this. There will come a Christian by, will be worth a Jew's eye.
What says that fool of Hagar's offspring? Huh?
These words are farewell, mistress. Nothing else.
The fool is kind enough, but a huge feeder. Snail slow in profit, and he sleeps by day more than a tomcat. Therefore, I part with him. Well, Jessica, go in. Perhaps I will return immediately. Do as I bid you.
If I do choose the right.
The one of them contains my picture, Prince. If you choose that, then I'm yours with all.
Some god direct my judgment. Let me see. Who chooseth me must give and hazard all he hath. Must give? For what? For lead? Hazard for lead? This casket, my friends, threatens. Men who hazard all do it in hope of fair advantages. A golden mind stoops not to show up dross, eh? I'll then no give no hazard out for lead, eh? Mm-mm. What says the silver with her virgin hue?
Who chooseth me shall gain as much as he deserve. Pause there, Morocco.
And weigh thy value with an even hand, huh?
I do in birth deserve her, and in fortunes, and in graces, and in qualities of...
What if I strain no further but choose here? Who chooseth me will gain what many men desire. Why, that's the lady! All of the world desires her. From the four corners of the earth, they come to kiss this shrine, this mortal breathing scent. Deliver me the key. Here do I choose, and thrive as I may.
There, take it, Prince. And if my form lie there, I am yours.
Hell. What have we here? All that glistens is not gold. Often have you heard that told. Gilded tombs do worms enfold. Are you well? Your suit is cold.
Shylock, I give thanks. The best esteemed acquaintances. Antonia, good health.
On the other hand, in faith it is a fair hand, and whiter than the paper it writ on is the fair hand that writ.
Love news in faith.
Meet me some hour hence.
This is the penthouse under which Lorenzo desired us to make stand. His hour is almost past.
And it is a marvel he outstays his hour, for lovers always run before the clock.
That ever holds. Who rises from a feast with that keen appetite that he sits down?
Sweet friends, your patience for my long delay. Oh! Who's within?
Who are you? Tell me for more certainty, old beard, I swear that I do know your tongue.
Lorenzo, and thy love.
Lorenzo, certain, and my love indeed. For who I love so much. And now who knows but you, Lorenzo, whether I am yours?
My heaven and thy thoughts are witness that thou art.
Here, catch this casket.
No!
It is worth the pains. I'm glad tis night. You do not look on me, for I am much ashamed of my disguise. love is blind. And lovers cannot see the pretty follies they themselves commit. For if they could, Cupid himself would blush to see me thus transformed into a boy.
Descend, for you must be my torchbearer.
It is an office of discovery, love, and I should be obscured.
So are you, sweet, even in the lovely garnish of a boy. But come at once, for the close night doth play the runaway.
I will go myself with some more ducats and be with you straight.
Condemn me, but I love her heartily, for she is wise, if I can judge of her. And fair she is, if that mine eyes be true. And true she is, as she hath proved herself. And therefore, like herself, wise, fair, and true, shall she be placed in my constant soul.
No!
Fly, fly, Graziano. 'Tis 10 o'clock. Our friends all wait for you. No market tonight. The wind has come about, Bassanio. Soon will come aboard. I have sent 20 out to seek for you.
Jessica! Jessica!
I will make some speed of my return.
Hurry not business for my sake, Bassanio, but say the very ripening for the time. And for the Jew's bond that he has of me, let him not enter your mind of love.
Ever
enter! Be merry. And employ your chiefest thoughts to courtship such fair displays of love as may conveniently become you there.
I never heard a passion so confused, so strange, outrageous, and so variable as the dull Jew did utter in the streets. My daughter, oh my ducats, oh my daughter.
The villain Jew with outcries raised the Duke, who went with him to search Bassanio's ship. He came too late. The ship was under sail.
Let good Antonio look he keep his day. Or he shall pay for this.
Marry, well remembered. I reasoned with a Frenchman yesterday, who told me in the narrow seas that part the French and English, there miscarried a vessel of our country, richly fraught. I thought upon Antonio when he told me, and wished in silence that it were not his.
Musica.
chooses me must give and hazard all he has. You shall look fairer ere I give or hazard. What says the golden chest? Huh. Let me see. Who chooses me shall gain what many men desire. I will not choose what many men desire, because I will not jump with common spirits and rank me with the barbarous multitude. Who chooses me shall get as much as he deserves. And well said, too.
I will assume desert. Give me a key for this.
And instantly unlock my fortunes here.
Too long a pause for that which you find there.
What's here? The portrait of a blinking idiot presenting me a schedule? Did I deserve no more than a fool's head? Is that my prize? Are my deserts no better?
To offend and judge are distinct offices and of opposite natures.
With one fool's head, I came to woo. But I go away with two.
Antonio's ship is wrecked. Gone down with all hands.
All merchandise lost.
News on the Rialto. Why, yet it lives there unchecked that Antonio has a ship of rich lading wrecked on the narrow seas. Goodwin's, I think they call the place.
Yes,
a very dangerous flat and fatal, where the carcasses of many a tall ship lie bellied.
What say you?
I would it might prove the end of his losses.
How now, Shylock?
What news amongst the merchants?
You knew of my daughter's flight. None so well. None so well as you.
And Shylock, for his own part, knew the bird was fledged. And then it is the complexion of them all to leave the dhow.
She be damned for it.
Tell us.
Do you hear whether Antonio have had any loss at sea or no?
Let him look to his bond. He was wont to call me usurer. Let him look to his bond. He was wont to lend money for Christian courtesy. Let him look to his bond.
I'm sure if you forfeit, you will not take his flesh. What's that good for?
To bait fish withal. If it will feed nothing else, it will feed my revenge. He hath disgraced me and hindered me 500,000. Laughed at my losses, mocked at my gains, scorned my nation. Thwarted my bargains, cooled my friends, heated mine enemies, and what's his reason? I am a Jew! Hath that a Jew eyes? Hath that a Jew hands? Organs? Dimensions? Senses? Affections? Passions? Fed with the same food? Hurt with the same weapons? Subject to the same diseases? Healed by the same means? Warmed and cooled by the same winter and summer as a Christian is. If you prick us, do we not bleed? If you tickle us, do we not laugh? If you poison us, do we not die? And if you wrong us, shall we not revenge? If we are like you in the rest, we will resemble you in that. If a Jew wrong a Christian, what is his humility? Revenge? If a Christian wrong a Jew, what should his sufferings be? By Christian example. Why revenge? The villainy you teach me, I will execute, and it shall go hard, but I will bet the instruction.
Antonio is at his house. We should speak with him.
Oh, no, Tubal. What news from Genoa? Have you found my daughter?
I often came where I did hear of her, but cannot find her.
Why? There. A diamond gone. Cost me 2,000 ducats in Frankfurt. The curse never fell upon our nation till now. I never felt it till now. I would my daughter were dead at my foot, and the Jew in her ear. No news of them. But loss upon loss. The thief gone with so much and so much to find the thief. And no satisfaction. No revenge. No ill luck stirring. But what lights on my shoulders? No. Sighs, but of my breathing. No tears, but of my shedding.
Yes. Other men have ill luck too. Antonio, as I heard in Genoa.
What?
Ill luck. As a ship wrecked coming from Tripolis.
Oh, thank God. Oh. Heard you in Genoa. What?
Your daughter spent in Genoa, as I heard. One night, 40 ducats.
stick a dagger in me, I shall never see my gold again.
40 ducats. At a sitting. 40 ducats.
There came various of Antonio's creditors in my company to Venice. That swear he cannot choose but break.
I am very glad of it. I'll plague him. I'll torture him. I am glad of it.
One of them showed me a ring he had of your daughter for a monkey.
Out on her! Jubal, you torture me. Was my tequoi. I had it of Leia, her mother, when I was a bachelor.
I would not have given it away for a wilderness of monkeys. But Antonio is certainly undone.
That is true. Jubal, go. Find me an officer. Bespeak him a fortnight before. I will have Antonio's heart if he forfeit. Go, good you. At our synagogue, you.
There is a light at your gate. A young Venetian, one who comes to signify the approaching of his lord. I have not seen so likely an ambassador of love. A day in April never came so sweet to show how costly summer was at hand as this forerunner comes before his lord.
No more, I pray you. I'm half afraid you will say anon here some kin to you who's been such high day wit in praising him. Come. Come, Nerissa, for I long to see quick Cupid's post that comes so manly. Bassanio, Lord Love, if you're willing to be. There's something tells me, but it is not love. I would not lose you. Yourself knows hate counsels not in such a quality. Before you venture for me, I could teach you how to choose right, but then I break my oath. That will I never do. So may you miss me. And if you do, you'll make me wish that sin that I had broke my oath. Invited me. One half of me is yours, the other half yours, mine own, I would say, but if mine, then yours, and so.
As I am, I live upon the rack.
Upon the rack, Bassanio? Then confess what treason there is mingled with your love.
None, but that ugly treason of mistrust, which makes me fear the enjoying of my love.
Aye, but I fear you speak upon the rack, when men in force do speak anything.
Promise me life, and I'll confess the truth.
Well then, confess and live.
confess and love has been the very sum of my confession. But let me do my fortune and the caskets.
Away then. I am locked in one of them.
Tell me, what is fancy bread? Or in the heart, or in the head? How big old, how nourishing?
Seasoned with a gracious voice, obscures the show of evil in religion. What damned error but some sober brow will bless it and approve it with a text, hiding the grossness with fair ornament. Look on beauty, and you shall see, 'tis purchased by the weight. Therefore, thou gaudy gold, I will none of you, nor none of you, O pale and common drudge between man and man, but you, O meager lead, which rather threatens than does promise aught. Your paleness moves me more than eloquence.
Here choose I.
Joy be the consequence.
Our love be moderate. I like your ecstasy. If you do much of blessing, make it less, but fear is sad.
What find I here?
Fair Portia's counterfeit.
What demigod has come so near creation? Move these eyes, or whether riding on the balls of mine seem they in motion. But our eyes, how could he see to do them? But look how far the substance of my praise does wrong this shadow and underpraising it. So far this shadow doth limp behind the substance.
Here's the scroll,
the continent and summary of my fortune. You that choose not by the view, chance is fair and choose is true. Since this fortune falls on you, be content and seek no new. If you be well pleased with this, and hold your fortune for your bliss, turn you where your lady is, and claim her with a loving kiss. By your leave, I come by note to give. And to receive.
Like one or two contending in a prize that thinks he has done well in people's eyes. Hearing applause and universal shout. Gideon's spirit still gazing and in doubt, as doubtful whether what I see be true. Until confirmed, signed, ratified by you.
You see me, Lord Bassanio, where I stand, such as I am. Though for myself alone, I would not be ambitious in my wish to wish myself much better. Yet for you, I would be trebled 20 times myself. 1,000 times more fair. 10,000 times more rich, that only to stand high in your account, I might in virtues, beauties, livings, friends, exceed account. But the full sum of me is sum of something which determined gross is an unlessoned girl, unschooled, unpracticed, happy in this, she is not yet so old, but she may learn. Happier than this, she is not bred so dull, but she may learn. Happiest of all, as that her gentle spirit commits itself to yours to be directed, as by her governor, her lord, her king. This house, these servants, and this same myself are yours, my lords. I give them with this ring, which when you part from, lose, or give away, let it presage the ruin of your love. And give me vantage to exclaim on you.
Madam. You have bereft me of all words. Only my blood speaks to you in my veins, and there is such confusion in my powers. But when this ring parts from this finger,
then parts life from thence. Or then be bold to say, Bassanio's dead.
And my gentle lady, I wish you all the joy that you can wish. And when your honors mean to solemnize the bargain of your faith, I do beseech you, even at that time, I may be married too.
With all my heart. If you can get a wife.
Thank you, Lordship. You have got me one. My eyes, my lord, can look as swift as yours. You saw the mistress. I beheld the maid.
Is it true, Nerissa?
Madam, it is.
And do you, Graziano, mean good faith?
Yes. Faith, my lord.
Our feast shall be much honored in your marriage.
Well, play with them! The first boy for 1,000 ducats.
Oh. What, and stake down?
No. We shall never win at that sport with stake down.
Comes here.
There are some shrewd contents in yon same paper. To steal the color from Bassanio's cheek. Some dear friend dead, else nothing in the world could turn the constitution of any constant man. What worse? Worse. With leave, Bassanio, I am half yourself, and I must freely have half of anything that this same letter brings you.
Sweet Portia, here are a few of the unpleasantest words that ever blotted me. When I did first impart my love to you, I freely told you all the wealth I had ran in my veins. I was a gentleman, and then I told you true, and yet, dear lady, rating myself at nothing, you shall see how much I was in bracket. When I told you my state was nothing, I should then have told you I was worse than nothing, for indeed, I have engaged myself to a dear friend. Engaged my dear friend to his mere enemy. To feed my means. Here is a letter, lady. The paper is the body of my friend and every word in it, a gaping wound, issuing lifeblood.
But is it true, Solerio? What all his ventures failed, what not one hit? From Tripolis, from Mexico, from England?
Not one, my lord. Besides, it should appear that if he had the present money to discharge the Duke, he would not take it. He plies the Duke at morning and at night and doth impeach the freedom of the state if they deny him justice. 20 merchants, the Duke himself, and the magnificos of greatest port of all, persuaded with him. But none can drive him from the envious plea of forfeiture, of justice, and his bond.
When I was with him, I have heard him swear to Tubal and to Cush, his countrymen, that he would rather have Antonio's flesh than 20 times the value of the sum that he did owe him. And I know, my lord, if law, authority, and power deny not, it will go hard with poor Antonio. Is it your dear friend that is thus in trouble?
The dearest friend to me.
What sum was he the Jew?
For me, 3,000 ducats.
No more. Pay him 6,000 and deface the bond. Double 6,000 and then treble that. Before a friend of this description should lose a hair through Bassanio's fault. Let me hear the letter of your friend.
Sweet Bassanio, my ships have all miscarried. My creditors grow cruel. My estate is very low. My bond to the Jew is forfeit, and since in paying it, it is impossible that I should live. All debts are clear between you and I. If I might but see you at my death, notwithstanding, use your pleasure. If love do not persuade you to come, let not my letter.
Dispatch all business and be gone. First, go with me to church and call me wife. Then, away to Venice to your friend. for never shall you lie by Portia's side with an unquiet soul. You shall have gold to pay the petty debt 20 times over. When it is paid, bring your true friend along. Meantime, myself and Nerissa will live as maids and widows. Come away, or you shall hence on your wedding day.
Jailer, look to him. Tell me not of mercy. This is the fool lent out money gratis. Jailer, look to him.
Hear me yet, good Shylock.
I'll have my bond. Speak not against my bond. I have sworn an oath that I will have my bond. You called me dog before you had a cause. But since I am a dog, beware my fangs. The Duke will grant me justice. I do wonder, you wicked jailers, you are so fond to come abroad with him at his request.
I pray you hear me speak.
I'll have my bond. I will not hear you speak. I'll have my bond. Therefore, speak no more. I'll not be made a soft and dull-eyed fool to shake the head, relent, and sigh, and yield to Christian intercessors. I'll have no speaking. Follow not. I will have my bond.
It is the most impenetrable cur that ever kept with men.
Let him alone. I'll follow him no more with bootless prayers. He seeks my life. His reason, well, I know.
I'm sure the Duke will never grant this forfeiture to hold.
The Duke cannot deny the course of law. For the commodity that strangers have with us in Venice, if it be denied, will much impeach the justice of the state. Therefore, go. Oh, these griefs and losses have so baited me that I shall hardly find a pound of flesh tomorrow for my bloody creditor.
God, Bassanio, come to see me pay his debt. And I care not.
Madam, if you knew to whom you show this honor, how true a gentleman you send relief, how dear a lover of my lord your husband, I know you would be prouder of the work than customary kindness would allow you.
I never did repent for doing good, nor shall not now. For in companions that do converse and waste the time together, there needs must be a like proportion of lineaments, of manners, and of spirit. Which makes me think that this Antonio, being the bosom lover of my lord, must needs be like my lord. If it be so, how little is the cost I have bestowed in purchasing the semblance of my soul from out of this state of hellish cruelty. Oh, this comes too near the praising of myself, therefore no more of it. Here are other things. Lorenzo, I commit into your hands the husbandry and manage of my house until my lord's return. For my own part, I have towards heaven breathed a secret vow to live in prayer and contemplation, only intended by Nerissa here, until my husband and her lord's return.
Madam, with all my heart, I shall obey you in all fair commands.
Fair thoughts and happy hours attend on you. Go. Speed to Padua. Render this into my cousin's hands, old Bellario. Go. Is it not so, cousin Mario?
Floor of heaven
is thick inlaid with patterns of bright gold. There's not the smallest orb that you behold, but in his motion, like an angel, sings. Such harmony is in immortal souls. How to us this muddy vesture of decay doth grossly close it in. We cannot hear it.
I am never merry when I hear sweet music.
The reason is your spirits are attentive. The man that hath no music in himself, nor is not moved with concord of sweet sounds, is fit for treasons, stratagems, and spoils. The motions of his spirit are as dull as night, and his affections are as dark as Erebus. Let no such man be trusted. Hark the music.
We shall see our husbands before they think of us.
Shall they see us?
They shall, Marissa. But in such a habit that they shall think we are accomplished with what we lack. I'll hold you any wager when we are both accoutred like young men. I'll prove the prettier fellow of the two.
Go one and call the Jew to the court. Make room. You stand before our face.
He has come, my lord.
Shylock, the world thinks, and I think so too, that you but leave this fashion of your malice to the last hour of the act. And then, 'tis thought you'll show your mercy and remorse, more strange than is your strange apparent cruelty.
What say you, Jew? We all expect a gentle answer.
I have informed your grace of what I purpose. And by our holy Sabbath have I sworn to have the due and forfeit of my bond. If you deny it, let the danger light upon your charter and your city's freedom. You'll ask me why I rather choose to have a weight of human flesh than to receive 3,000 ducats. I'll not answer that, but say it is my humor. Is it answered? What if my house be troubled by a rat, and I am pleased to give 10,000 ducats to have it killed? What? Are you answered yet? Some men there are love not a gaping pig, some that are mad if they behold a cat, and others, when the bagpipe sings in the nose, cannot contain their urine. For affection, master of passion, sways it to the mood of what it likes or loathes. Now for your answer. As there is no firm reason to be rendered why he cannot abide a gaping pig, why he, a harmless, necessary cat, why he, a woolen bagpipe, but of force must yield to such inevitable shame as to offend himself being offended, so can I give no reason, nor will I not, more than a lodged hate and a certain loathing I bear Antonio, that I follow thus this losing suit against him. Are you answered?
No!
This is no answer.
You unfeeling man, to excuse the current of your cruelty.
I am not bound to please you with my answers.
All men kill the things they do not love.
Hates any man the thing he would not kill.
Every offense is not a hate at first.
You would have a serpent sting you twice?
No!
I pray you,
think you question with the Jew. You may as well go stand upon the beach and bid the main flood lower its usual height. You may as well question with the wolf why he has made the ewe bleat for the lamb. You may as well do anything most hard as seek to soften that. And which what's harder, his Jewish heart. Therefore, I do beseech you, make no more offers, use no farther means, but with all just and plain conveniency, let me have judgment and the Jew his will.
No! No!
Here is six.
If every ducat in 6,000 ducats were in six parts, and every part a ducat, I would not draw them. I would have my bond.
How shall you hope for mercy, giving none?
What judgment should I fear, doing no wrong? You have among you many a purchased slave, which, like your asses and your dogs and mules, you use in abject and in slavish parts because you bought them. Shall I say to you, let them be free? Marry them to your heirs. Why sweat they under burdens? Let their beds be made as soft as yours, their palates seasoned with your food. You will answer, the slaves are ours. So do I answer you. The pound of flesh that I demand of him is dearly bought. 'Tis mine. 'Tis mine! 'Tis mine. And I will have it. If you deny me, fie upon your law! There is no force in the decrees of Venice. I stand for judgment. Answer. Shall I have it?
Silence! 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 Upon my power, I may dismiss this court, unless Bellario, a learned doctor that I have sent for to determine this, come here today.
My lord. Here stays without a messenger with letters from the doctor, and you come from Padua.
Coming from Padua? From old Bellario?
From both, my lord. Bellario greets your grace.
Why do you whet your knife so earnestly?
To cut the forfeiture from that bankrupt there.
And no prayers, please!
No. None that you have wit enough to.
Be you damned! For your life, let justice be accused.
Till you can rail the seal from off my bond, you but offend your lungs to speak so. Prepare your wit, good youth, or it will fall to cureless ruin. I stand here for law.
No!
I stand for law!
This letter does commend a young and learned doctor to our court.
Well, where is he?
He attendeth here hard by to know your answer, whether you'll admit him.
Go, give him courteous conduct to this place. Meantime, the court shall hear Bellario's letter. Your grace shall understand that at the receipt of your letter, I am very sick. But in the instant your messenger came, there was with me a young doctor of Rome, whose name is Balthazar. He comes at my asking to take my place. I beseech you, let his lack of years be no impediment, for I never knew so young a body with so old a head.
I leave him to your gracious acceptance. You heard Bellario, what he writes.
Oh, and here, I take it, is the doctor come.
You are welcome.
Take your place. Are you acquainted with the difference that holds this present question in the court?
I am informed thoroughly of the case. Which is the merchant here, and which the Jew?
Antonio and old Shylock, both stand forth.
Is your name Shylock?
Shylock is my name.
Of a strange nature is the suit you follow. Yet in such rule that the Venetian law cannot deny you as you do proceed. You stand within his power, do you not?
Aye, so he says.
Do you confess the bond?
I do.
Then must the Jew be merciful.
On what compulsion must I? Tell me that.
The quality of mercy is not strained. It droppeth. It's the gentle rain from heaven upon the place beneath. It is twice blessed. It blesseth him that gives and him that takes. 'Tis mightiest in the mighty. It becomes the throned monarch better than his crown. His scepter shows the force of temporal power, the attribute to awe and majesty, wherein doth sit the dread and fear of kings. But mercy is above this sceptred sway. It is enthroned in the heart of kings. It is an attribute to God himself. And earthly power doth then show like his gods when mercy seasons justice. Therefore, Jew, though justice be your plea, consider this, that in the course of justice, none of us should see salvation. We do pray for mercy, and that same prayer doth teach us all to render the deeds of mercy. I have spoke thus much to mitigate the justice of your plea, which if you follow, the strict course of Venice must needs give sentence against the merchant there.
My deeds upon my head. I crave the law, the penalty and forfeit of my bond.
Is he not able to discharge the money?
Yes, here. I tender it for him in court, yea, twice the sum. If that is not enough, I will be bound to pay it 10 times, on forfeit of my hands, my head, my heart. If this is not enough, it must appear that malice bears down on truth. I beseech you, rest once the law to your authority to do a great right, do a little wrong, and curb this cruel devil of his will.
It must not be. There is no power in Venice can alter a decree established. We recorded for a precedent, and many an heir of the same example will rush into the state. It cannot be.
Hey, Daniel! Come to judgment. Wise young judge, how I do honor you.
I pray you let me look upon the bond.
Most reverend doctor, here it is.
Shylock, there is twice the money offered you.
An oath! An oath. I have an oath in heaven. Shall I lay perjury upon my soul? No. Not for Venice.
Why, this bond is forfeit. And lawfully at this time the Jew may claim a pound of flesh. To be by him cut off nearest the merchant's heart. Be merciful. Take twice your money. Bid me tear the bond.
When it is paid, according to the terms.
Most heartily, I do beseech the court to give the judgment.
Then thus it is. You must prepare your bosom for his knife.
O noble judge. Excellent young man.
For the intent and purpose of the law has full relation to the penalty, which here appeareth due upon the bond.
'Tis very true. A wise and upright judge. How much more elder are you than you look?
Therefore lay bare your bosom.
Aye, his breast. So says the bond, does it not, noble judge? Nearest the heart. Those are the very words.
It is so. Are there balances here to weigh the flesh?
I have them. Here.
Some surgeon, Shylock, on your charge, to stop his wounds, lest he should bleed to death.
Is it so nominated in the bond?
It is not so expressed. But what of that 'twere good you do so much for charity?
I cannot find it. 'Tis not in the bond.
You merchant, have you anything to say?
Grieve not that I'm formed to this for you. For herein doth fortune show herself more kind than is her custom. Commend me to thy honorable wife. Tell her the process of Antonio's end. Say how I loved you. Speak me fair in death. And when the tale is told, bid her be judge whether Bassanio had not once a love. Repent but you that you shall lose your friend. And he repents not that he pays your debt. For if the Jew do cut but deep enough, I'll pay it instantly with all my heart.
Antonio, I am married to a wife which is as dear to me as life itself. For life itself, my wife, and all the world are not with me esteemed above your life. I would lose all that, sacrifice them all here to this devil.
I have a wife who I protest I love. I would she were in heaven, so she could entreat some power to change this cursed Jew.
I had a daughter. Would that any of the stock of Barabbas been her husband rather than a Christian? We trifle time. I pray you, pursue sentence.
You may proceed.
A pound of that same merchant's flesh is yours. The court awards it, and the law does give it.
Most rightful, judge.
And you must cut this flesh from off his breast. The court awards it, and the law allows it.
Most learned, judge. A sentence. Come.
A little. There is something else. This bond does give you here no drop of blood. The words expressly are a pound of flesh. Take then your bond. Take then your pound of flesh. But in the cutting of it, if you do shed one drop of Christian blood, your lands and goods are by the laws of Venice confiscate. And to the state of Venice.
Oh, upright judge. Mark, Jew. Learned judge. Is that the law?
Yourself shall see the act. For as you urge on justice, be assured, you shall have justice more than you desire.
I take the offer, then. Pay the bond twice, and let the Christian go.
Here is the money.
Soft. The Jew shall have all justice. No haste. He shall have nothing but the penalty. Therefore, prepare you to cut off the flesh. Shed then no blood, nor cut you less nor more, but just a pound of flesh. If you take more or less than a just pound, be it but so much as makes it light or heavy, in the substance or division of the 20th part of one poor scruple, nay, if the scale do turn but in the estimation of a hair, you die, and all your goods are confiscated.
A second Daniel.
Now, infidel, I have you on the hip.
Why just that you pause?
Shall I not have even my prince?
You shall have nothing but your forfeiture. To be so taken at your peril, Jew.
By the devil, give him good of it. I'll stay, no longer question.
Tarry, Jew, the law has yet another hold on you. It is enacted in the laws of Venice. If it be proved against an alien that by direct or indirect attempts he seek the life of any citizen, the party against which he does contrive shall seize one half of his goods. The other half comes to the privy coffer of the state. And the offender's life lies in the mercy of the Duke only, against all other voice. In which predicament, I say, you stand? Down, therefore, and beg mercy of the Duke.
Beg that you may have leave to hang yourself.
That you shall see the difference in our spirit. I pardon you your life, before you ask it. For half your wealth, it is Antonio's. The other half shall come to the general state.
Nay, take my life, and all, pardon not that. You take my house when you take the prop that doth sustain my house. You take my life, or you take the means whereby I live.
What mercy can you render him, Antonio?
A halter, gratis, nothing else, for God's sake.
So please, my lord the Duke, and all the court, forego the fine of one half his goods. I am content, so he will let me use the other half in trust. Relinquish it upon his death,
to the gentleman that lately stole his daughter. One thing provided more than for this vapor. He shall presently become a Christian.
He shall do this, or else I do recant the pardon I late pronounce it here.
Are you contented, Jew? What do you say?
Well, I'm content.
Clark, prepare a deed of gift.
I pray you give me leave to go from hence. I am not well. I will send the deed after me. I will sign it.
Get you gone then, but do it. Court dismissed.
O swarthy gentlemen, I and my friend have by your wisdom been this day acquitted of most grievous penalties, in lieu whereof 3,000 ducats due unto the Jew, we freely pay your courteous pains withal.
And stand indebted over and above in love and service to you evermore.
He is well paid that is well satisfied, and I delivering you am satisfied, and therein do account myself well paid. Pay you well.
Dear sir, of course I must attend you further. Take some remembrance of us, as a tribute, not as a fee. Grant me two things, I pray you. Not to deny me, and to pardon me.
You press me far, therefore I will yield. Give me your gloves. I'll wear them for your sake. And for your love, I'll take this ring from you. Do not draw back your hand. I'll take no more, and you in love shall not deny me this.
This ring, good sir, alas, it is a trifle. I would not shame myself to give you this.
I will have nothing else but only this.
There's more depends on this than on the value. The dearest ring in all of Venice will I give to you and find it out by proclamation. Only for this I pray you. Pardon me.
Oh, I see, sir. You are liberal in offers. You taught me first to beg, and now methinks you teach me how a beggar should be answered.
This ring was given me by my wife.
Oh.
And when she put it on, she made me vow that I should neither sell nor give. Nor lose it.
That excuse serves many men to save their gifts. And if your wife be not a madwoman, and know how well I have deserved this ring, she could not hold out enemy forever for giving it to me.
My lord Bassanio, let him have the ring. Let not his deserving and my love as well be valued against your wife's commandment.
Inquire the Jew's house out. Give him this deed and let him sign it.
My lord Bassanio, upon more advice, has sent you here this ring and does entreat your company at dinner.
That cannot be. His ring, I do accept,
Most thankfully. I pray you tell him. Furthermore, I pray you show my youth to old Shylock's house.
That will I do.
I'll see if I can get my husband's ring, which I did make him swear to keep forever.
Dear ladies, welcome home.
We have been praying for our husband's welfare, whose speed we hope the better for our lives.
Looks a little paler. 'Tis a day such as the days when the sun is hid. Peace.
You're welcome home, my lord.
I thank you, madam. Give welcome to my friend. This is the man, this is Antonio, to whom I am so infinitely bound.
You should, in all sense, be much bound to him. For as I hear, he was much bound for you.
No more than I am well acquitted of.
Sir, you are welcome to our house. It must appear in other ways than words. So I cut short this breathing courtesy.
By yonder moon, I swear, you do me wrong. In faith, I gave it to the judge's clerk. Would he were gelded that had it for my part, since you do take it, love, so much at heart.
A quarrel, ho, already? What's the matter?
About a hoop of gold, a paltry ring that she did give me, whose motto was for all the world like cutler's poetry upon a knife. Love me and leave me not.
What took you of the motto or the value? You swore to me when I did give it you that you would wear it till your hour of death and that it should lie with you in your grave. Though not for me, yet for your vehement oaths, you should have been respective and have kept it. Gave it to judge's clerk!
I gave it to a youth! A kind of boy, a little scrubby boy, no higher than thyself, the judge's clerk!
You were to blame, I must be plain with you, to part so slightly with your wife's first gift. I gave my love a ring, and made him swear never to part with it. And here he stands. I dare be sworn for him, he would not lose it, nor pluck it from his finger for all the wealth that the world masters.
Why, I were best to cut my left hand off and swear I lost the ring defending it.
My lord Bassanio gave his ring away. Mm. And to the judge that begged it. And indeed deserved it too. And then the boy, his clerk, that took some pain in writing, he begged mine. And neither man nor master would take aught but the two rings.
If I could add a lie unto a fault, I would deny it. But you see, my finger is not the ring upon it. It is gone.
Even so void is your false heart of truth. By heaven, I will ne'er come into your bed until I see the ring, nor I in yours till I again see mine.
Sweet Portia, if you did know to whom I gave the ring, if you did know for whom I gave the ring, and would conceive for what I gave the ring, and how unwillingly I left the ring when naught would be accepted but the ring,
if you had known the virtue of the ring, or half her worthiness, would it give the ring, or your own honor,
to contain the ring. You would not then have parted with the ring. Nerissa teaches me what to believe. I'll die for it, but some woman has that ring.
No, by my honor, madam, by my soul, no woman had it, but a civil doctor, which did refuse 3,000 ducats of me and begged the ring, the which I did refuse him and suffered him displeased to go away, even he that had held up the very life of my dear friend. What should I say, sweet lady? I was enforced to send it after him.
Let not that doctor come near my house, since he has got the jewel that I loved and that which you did swear to keep for me. I will become as liberal as you. I'll not deny him anything I have. No, not since my body nor my husband's bed. No, my shell, I'm sure of that.
Portia. Forgive me this enforced wrong, and in the hearing of these many friends, I swear to thee, even by thine own fair eyes, I nevermore will break an oath with thee.
I once did lend my body for his wealth. I dare be bound again, my soul upon the forfeit. But your lord will nevermore break faith advisedly.
Then you shall be his surety. Give him this, and bid him keep it better than the other.
Admiral Pisanio, swear to keep this ring.
By heaven. It's the same I gave the doctor.
I had it of him. Pardon me, Bassanio. For by this ring, the doctor lay with me. And pardon me, my gentle Graziano, for that same scrubbed boy, the doctor's clerk, in lieu of this, last night did lie with me.
Why? This is like the mending of the highways. In summer, when the ways are fair enough! What? Are we cuckolds? And we have deserved it.
Speak not so grossly. You are all amazed. Bassanio, here is a letter. It comes from Padua, from old Bellario. There you shall read that Portia was the doctor. Nerissa there, her clerk. Lorenzo here shall witness I set forth as soon as you, and only just now returned.
Were you the doctor?
And I knew you not.
Were you the clerk? That is to make me cuckold.
I? But the clerk that never means to do it, unless he live to be a man.
Sweet doctor, you shall be my bedfellow. When I am absent, then lie with my wife.
How now, Lorenzo? My clerk has some good comforts, too, for you.
Aye, there do I give to you and Jessica from the rich, too, a special deed of gift after his death of all he dies possessed.
Fair ladies, you drop manna in the way of starved people.
It is almost morning, and yet I am sure you are not satisfied with these events at full. Let us go in, and I will answer all things
faithfully.
Well, let it be so. The first interrogatory that my Nerissa shall be sworn on is whether till the next night she'd rather stay or go to bed now, being 2 hours today. Where the day come, I should wish it dark till I were couching with the doctor's clerk. while I live, I'll fear no other thing so sore as keeping safe Nerissa's ring.
But he spoke to me.